Why do we study music history, and why is it important to know the history of music? Let's start by asking a question. Why not study the history of music? Well, obviously because who cares? Learning to play an instrument is both fun and rewarding. Learning music theory can give you a deeper understanding of a piece and can help you create music of your own. But what does music history do? It's just a collection of contingent facts about what happened and how it happened. Now let's dissect this view. What exactly is a collection of contingent facts? It means first that music history is a collection of facts, which means that it's a series of events added on top of each other. It also means that doing music history is kind of like keeping a diary of all the musical events that happen. And second, that these facts are contingent, meaning that they happen to go a certain way, but could have gone a different way. Why? Because an intellectual field of study is supposed to have some sort of necessity about it. For example, they wouldn't teach you Newtonian physics if an object in free fall could suddenly say, "I'm sick of this whole gravity shit," and then start moving up. Music history is dismissed because there's no necessity. Because it's just based on the stuff that certain composers did. And if they weren't born, something else would have happened. Let's deal with this view in a real problem. We all know that around 1802, Beethoven went through a profound personal crisis, and he even considered killing himself. He wrote his final testament and said his goodbyes, but then something occurred to him. Why don't I just write different music instead of killing myself? And that's when he started composing pieces like the Eroica and all the other pieces he's famous for. Now here we can ask an interesting question. Would the history of Western music look the same if Beethoven had in fact killed himself? What would 19th century music look like if there was no Eroica or the later Beethoven works? There's no way that we can answer this question in an absolutely certain way, but we can think about its answer by looking closely at history. Yes, we often say that Beethoven's new path changed music forever, but was it really Beethoven that created this new path? Here, the situation seems to be far more complicated. We often think of great thinkers or creators as people who come up with amazing ideas that no one else ever thought of. This means that we forget first that they were responding to problems which were created by the field itself. And second, that their responses didn't come out of nowhere. And in most cases, they were the result of reworking and perfecting the responses which already existed. For example, we all admire Darwin for being the genius that came up with the brilliant idea of the evolution of species. But we have to consider the fact that, first of all, he wasn't the only person working on this problem. From at least the 18th century, the works of other scientists like de Maillet, Cuvier, and Laplace had introduced the problem of evolutionary change in the universe. And since the time of the ancient Greeks, we had different people theorizing about animal species evolving. When Darwin himself was working on the idea, other scientists like Lamarck and Wallace were also considering similar ideas. The same applies in the history of music. Yes, Beethoven's music was something new, but the Romantic movement was already a strong movement in German-speaking lands. Haydn and Mozart had already experimented with storm and stress ideas in their symphonies. The dramatic power of Mozart's lay piano concerti clearly anticipated Beethoven, and the thematic integrity of Beethoven's mature music is already present in the late Haydn. So the forces that led Beethoven to redefine his style were a result of the recent developments in music itself. And the elements that Beethoven used to create his new style also already existed. So if he had killed himself, of course we would see some change in the history of music, but those forces and those problems would still have to be responded to. So the main problem with this first view about music history is that it ignores the fact that composers don't just write any music that they like. A serious composer is a person who works on a musical problem which needs to be answered. This is the necessity which turns music history into something more than a collection of facts. But what exactly are these musical problems? Let's talk about a few examples by asking a simple question. Why would someone listen to a sound? When there's someone singing, we look at the meaning of their words. But when there's pure instrumental music, what are we supposed to do with it? Now, pure instrumental music is as old as music itself, but before the 18th century, it always had a secondary position compared to music with human voices. Joseph Haydn was one of the most important composers who worked on the problem of giving meaning to pure instrumental music. Haydn solved the problem by introducing small musical ideas and then deriving other musical ideas from it through the process of thematic work. He also established formal and harmonic expectations to be able to break them and produce meaningful musical gestures like his famous jokes. But here's the important thing. Haydn wasn't the first composer to use harmonic poles. He didn't invent the notion of musical motif, and all the forms that he used were also already being used by other composers. What he did was to give these elements a new meaning by combining them in a new way in response to a musical problem. Now, a musical problem doesn't necessarily have to be about something as deep as the meaning of music. For example, Schubert inherited two different musical traditions. One was the heroic symphonic tradition of Beethoven, and the other one was the lyric tradition of salon music. The musical problem that Schubert worked on in pieces like the Unfinished Symphony, the 21st Piano Sonata, or the Quintet in C Major was to try and find a way to reconcile these two traditions. We can go on and on about different musical problems that different composers have dealt with, but the point is already established. Just like the way a new scientific or philosophical theory produces a new set of questions which need to be answered, a new musical style also gives rise to a set of musical problems. This is our second view on music history. We study music history to understand musical problems and to understand how the works of different composers are shaped by their responses to those problems. This means that studying music history doesn't just give us background information about that piece or that composer, but it also gives us a deeper understanding of the music too. So what's wrong with this view? Well, nothing. It's not that it's wrong, but it's only a partial view. According to this view, music history is just a field full of potential meaning that we can dig into, but it doesn't produce anything new. Now you might say, well, how is history supposed to produce something new? Haven't all the stuff in history already happened? Here we need to talk a little bit about the meaning of history itself. What is history? Yes, history is built from a collection of stuff that have already happened. But providing a complete collection of all the events, causes, factors, and tendencies which interact with each other and influence the movement of history is actually impossible. This means that any historical narrative is a partial view based on what the historian finds important and the methods and the concepts that they use. To the extent that history is tied to these factors, it is not just a collection of facts, but it's actually a creative work. When we look at the history of the concept of history, we can get interesting insights about how this process works. We can see that historians working in different periods understand and analyze history in very different ways. We also see new and different methods of historical analysis being introduced, or even new evidence being found. This means that a historical narrative is always open to reworking and reinterpretation, and this makes music history productive. Why? Because when you rework a historical narrative, your relationship with that tradition also changes, and the implications of this change could produce something new which itself becomes a moving force in history. For example, in music history, we can think of Schoenberg and the Second Viennese School as an interesting example. All German composers after Beethoven felt the pressure of that tradition. But it was Schoenberg that produced a historical narrative which created something new. He argued that the whole history of Western music could be rewritten as the history of the dissonance losing its tendency to resolve. In Schoenberg's account, since the 16th century, more and more of the notes which were treated as dissonance have remained in the musical texture. This led him to develop an approach to harmony which didn't rely on the opposition between dissonance and consonance. Schoenberg's followers also adopted this historical narrative. Leibowitz, in fact, wrote a book in which all the history of Western music were covered in two chapters as the stages which followed the line of evolution which necessarily led to Schoenberg. So Schoenberg and his followers created a historical narrative which, just like any other historical narrative, is partial and relies on analyses and assumptions that can be challenged. But regardless of how accurate or inaccurate that view is, it became a moving force in the history of music, and two later generations were influenced by it. Now that composers no longer feel pressure to adopt the 12-tone technique, we can see composers like Philip Glass rethinking the narrative of 20th century music. He argues that the mainstream and contemporary music are tonal composers like Sibelius, Shostakovich, and Copland. In music theory too, Dmitri Timascho has introduced the concept of extended common practice. One of the goals of this new concept is to challenge the historical narrative which focuses on the breakdown of tonality and music necessarily leading to Schoenberg. So this is why music history isn't just about understanding music, but it's also a force that can change music.